Hi everybody, very welcome to Mentor and yet another video podcast. As always, I hope you're doing absolutely fantastic. Today I have a real treat for you guys. Today I have with us my wife and former flight attendant, Sandra. And we are going to be asking her quite a few tricky questions about life as a flight attendant. So stay tuned.
Wind 310 16, turn right, turn on.
Third land, 31 right.
Delta 260.
All right, Sandra, thank you for being with me on the channel for once.
You're welcome.
Cool. So the way that this works and the way that this came about was I sent out a question to my Patreons about what they wanted to know about life as a flight attendant. Mm-hmm. And I had loads and loads of questions. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to fire them off and then you can answer whatever you want.
Okay.
And we'll see if something comes up that maybe surprises us. So, the first question. Did a passenger ever hit on you or send or give you like a little note with his number or something like that?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. And how did that feel?
It wasn't nice feeling. I mean, it wasn't horrible either. But it's just like,
Why? I mean, isn't it nice if someone hits on you?
Oh, I don't think so. When you're working and, you know, it wasn't really my type either.
Oh, all right. So it wasn't a good looking guy, that's why.
I mean, probably, yeah, I'm good looking for a lot of people, but not my type.
And I'm very happy to hear that. okay, so follow-up question to that then. Did any pilots hit on you? Anyone that I should be hunting down?
Not at this stage now, but no. Yes, there was, yes.
In the work environment as well?
In the work environment, yes.
But how do you deal with that then, if you're a flight attendant? I mean, they're your superiors in the chain of command.
I mean, you just try to laugh it off, like pretend they're joking and that's it, you know. I wasn't trying to like, to be too angry or anything like that. Just like,
just laugh it off, basically.
Laugh it off and change the conversation, or just I have to do this and just go and that's it. Except that one time that I was like, I forgot about it. I was picking up the litter.
The trash,
like during the turnaround. And of course you're like bending because it's on the floor. Mm-hmm. And then you have the bag and you're picking up the biggest stuff before the passengers come in, and one of them actually slapped me in the ass.
No.
Yes.
Was this during the time that I was there?
Yes,
because we worked in the same airline. I should mention that as
yes.
well.
All yes.
Right, so now I might actually have to start hunting someone now.
I didn't slap him in the face because I thought that it would be bad, but I told him like to not ever do that again. Ever, and very seriously, obviously, and then it never happened again, so.
All right, now I should be saying at this point, guys, is that if you're going for a career in the flight deck, no matter if you're a man or a woman, like I was saying before, you are going to be at the top of the chain of command, and the cabin crew will come below you in descending order, which means that you are in a management position. So if you would ever do something like that, the risk of you actually getting a lawsuit against you for sexual harassment is extremely high. All right, this is not something that you should ever do. Now, if you want to hit on a flight attendant, you do that outside of work,
just like you did.
Like I did.
That was exactly. Actually very good.
Which was obviously successful since we're married now for several years. So, right, cool. So that's, it's a tricky situation to be in.
And there was more, but you know, you just laugh it out and that's it.
The thing to remember here, once again, guys, is that this is a working environment, and a working environment should be a professional environment, and that's really all that there is to it. So, going down to the second question, what did you feel was the best part of being a flight attendant?
Well, I like the fact that there was no days that they were the same. Mm-hmm. Like, you had different destinations, even though we were staying... it's for William. Even though we were staying, like, in the aircraft, we weren't going out for, like, overnight or anything, but it was different destinations. Like, for example, in Sweden, it was, like, winter and really cold, minus degrees, you know, but then you landed in Malta and opened the door and it was sunny and warm. It's like, oh, you know, like,
yeah, I don't know.
So that was really nice. And also, like, there were some days where the crew, like flight crew and cabin crew, you know, like, it was really good feeling and it was just a blast.
Yeah,
you know, like,
this is pretty similar to why I love being a pilot as well, that every day is different. And
yeah.
You work with really cool people and it's a really nice team experience and stuff,
yeah.
So that's
yeah.
Nice. Okay, so what was the most irritating thing that the pilots, the flight deck, could do to you when you were working? And I should be saying as well that Sandra was working both in the beginning as a junior, as in a junior cabin crew, and then you were also a purser towards the end of your career.
Yes.
So, from a pilot's perspective, is there anything that we should avoid doing? Something that you might think is annoying, but we don't understand it?
Well, sometimes, like, you know, you're busy in the cabin. You're doing the services, you're taking care of people, especially if it's a full flight. You might not have that much time to actually take their calls, like, or stop what you're doing for them to go to the toilets.
We do want to go to the toilet. So.
Yeah, I understand. But, you know, like, take the same chance that you call and there's already, like, everything established to actually both of you go to the toilet.
Mm.
Instead of calling after 7.5 minutes, I wanted to go to the toilet again. So once you start it again, then you have to stop, you know, like...
Yeah, but the thing is, we are at the mercy of you guys.
Yeah, I do understand that. But maybe plan, you know, like, I don't feel like going to the toilet now, but maybe in 7.5 minutes or 10 or 15 I need. So I'll take the chance now to do it, you know.
Okay, so respect basically that you guys are working quite hard, even...
Yeah, or sometimes it's just like, maybe it's... toilet, and then after 10 minutes it's a coffee, and then after 10 minutes it's heat up my food, and then it's, you know, so it's all the time that you have to leave what you're doing to actually undo. And I do understand you're locked in there and you have your needs also, but maybe, like, in one call you can just take everything out. I need the coffee, I want to go to the toilet,
and my food,
heat my food,
but then
yes.
My coffee is going to be cold when I have eaten my food, you know. This is a problem that we have since we're locked inside of that tiny little closet.
Or you can just say, you know, when you bring my food, can you bring my coffee also at
the same
time, you know, like, things like that. Maybe you guys don't think about it, and I do understand, but it makes life behind really much easier.
What about communication when it comes to, for example, bad weather ahead, or a go around, or a possibility of a go around and stuff? Did you feel that was good or something that we could improve on?
Normally, yes. Normally, it was just a few times that we had go arounds without us knowing anything about it.
Hmm.
But normally, they were calling us up ahead, or, you know, we were in. Call into the flight deck and we were explained face to face, like, listen, there's bad weather, we're gonna try to land, a lot of fog, whatever the situation was, otherwise there's a possibility, big chance of a go around, or, you know. So we normally were briefed for that.
That's the thing, yeah, since we do a lot of pre-flight planning, and we know when we're going into a place where there's fog, for example, we would already at briefing
sometimes before taking off we already knew that we might not be able to land in that destination.
Obviously this is not something that we communicate with passengers at that point, because, to be perfectly honest, even if it looks like it might be fog when we get there, they might not be. It might have disappeared, or the visibility might be just fine. And telling passengers at a very early stage that there's a possibility of a go around or a diversion is just going to heighten the anxiety level. So
it's unnecessary worrying.
Yeah. So we would brief the cabin crew to say that this is something that could potentially happen. And then as we get closer to our destination, I would call them up as well and tell them, listen, you know, the weather hasn't gotten better, so just be aware, prepare your PAs and things like that. And we might end up at our alternate, so have that in mind. It's all about increasing situational awareness,
yes.
Really. But it's good that you felt that was being done.
That was normally, I think it was just a couple of times that we were about to land and then go around. I was like, what? And of course, immediately all the passengers, especially when you sit at the front, they're all facing at you, you know, like, and immediately they all look at you and you're like,
of course. Yeah, but I mean, of course they do. But that brings me into my next question that my Patreon sent in, and that is, have you ever been in a situation where you actually felt afraid, but you had to kind of keep your face straight in order not to scare passengers?
No, not really. No.
No. Good.
No. No, because I do trust. I mean, I'm not afraid of flying, obviously, and I do trust you guys at the front, so... No.
Yeah, so that's always something that I bring up when we talk to people who are nervous flyers, is that they should be just looking at their professional cabin crew and see how they're reacting and how their like a body language is. And you'll find that someone who's experienced, like specifically the purser, because you might actually have junior cabin crew members who have never done a go-around. Like you could be in a flight like that.
Yeah, they're just new. Like they've been flying for only a couple of weeks and they're also excited themselves.
Yeah. So they might show a different body language, but if you look at the most senior person and look at how they react, then you'll have a fairly good grasp, you know, about how you should
be feeling.
I mean,
if there's turbulence or anything going on and you see the cabin crew, they're sitting, chatting around or like drinking their coffee or preparing their stuff to work, or everything is fine.
Yeah.
It's when you see them crying that, you know,
and you that, yeah,
that never happens.
That's never happened. No, but it's a good thing for you guys to know that, like, for example, Sandra, how do you feel about turbulence?
Oh, I like them. I love them.
And why is that?
I don't know. Like, I mean, when we were working, we've had those like cloud turbulence. You know, when you're just like climbing, that you go through them. It's like, I like them. And then if they were severe, obviously, or moderates, like we had to put all the trolleys away and, you know, like, so we take the chance to like talk to the colleagues, what you're doing, because of course we couldn't do anything and or eat, or, you know, like, so it was a little bit of a break for us, actually. So I associate it like with a positive thing.
And that's something that you really, if you're a nervous flyer out there, you should really be thinking about that. That's how the cabin crew think about turbulence. Like, oh, a break, a nice time. Yeah. And also, I agree with you. Some light turbulence, actually.
I like them. Yeah, now when I fly as a passenger and we have those climbing turbulence through the clouds, I just like... sit down and enjoy them. I like them.
Cool. All right. So obviously, since these are questions sent in by my patrons, they would ask, was there ever any mischief going on? Any stuff that you would do when the passengers were not around? Things like that?
Yeah. Like, I think like everyone that has been working as a cabin crew has gotten themselves into the overhead locker.
No.
Yeah, I have to say that getting in is easier than climbing down.
Okay.
Because, you know, we're wearing like tight skirts, knee length. So, you know, it's not easy to like, but yeah, like that. And then we put music sometimes with the PA system, you know, the whole plane, if we had delays or have to wait for passengers or something.
All right, cool.
Yeah.
Anything else?
Well, I've heard that some people has used magazines.
Well, like the in-flight safety magazines?
Yeah, to like when you fly empty, to sit, you know, on the magazine, because it's like plasticky and it slides. Mm-hmm. So then they were sliding during takeoff. But
well, never, in the middle aisle?
Yeah, never seen, never heard.
Don't do that. All right, that's a big no-no.
Never seen, never done myself. I've heard about it.
Oh, of course.
Yes.
But things, and this was actually a specific question I got from one of my admins in the Mentor Aviation app, from Adrian, and he asked, have you ever like purposely spilled coffee or something on a passenger because they've been misbehaving or anything like that?
No.
Have you heard of anyone who's done that?
No.
All right. I have, okay. When I was beginning in Stansted back in 2002, there was some cabin crew that was notorious. Not for spilling coffee, because that can actually hurt someone bad.
Mm-hmm.
But there was this one cabin crew who would ram into people who had their knees out in the aisle.
Yeah.
And she would actually run into them on purpose and say like, "Ooh, you pay for your seat and not for your aisle." She was fired. not surprisingly. But she was there for quite a while. And but these kind of things...
Well, I never did that.
The passengers are our customers. Those are the ones that pay our salary at the end of the day.
Yeah.
You don't do those kind of things.
No
exactly. All right. So this is also a question that that I've been getting a lot, and I'm guessing you probably have as well, and that is, if both pilots were incapacitated, would you be able to find your way around in the cockpit and potentially get in contact with our traffic control and let them maybe lead you down?
I mean, at that time when I was working, probably I would have better chances than now. Now, I mean, I forgot quite a lot.
You do listen to my podcast, so...
Yeah,
of course. All the time. You follow them religiously.
All the time.
Yeah,
I have the little bell and everything.
Oh, okay, good. I have actually a video about how to do that, so you can check that out.
But to become a cabin crew, I did the course. We had to do a course in Spain, and that course is like around 8 months. And we had the pilot doing our course, and it's like aerodynamics, hydraulics, navigation, engines, jet engines. Then we had like a nurse doing like some first aid.
Meteorology and stuff as well.
Yeah. So we more or less like systems, you know, like...
Yeah, this blew my mind the first time I saw it, because I had no idea. And this is a, you know, the differences between different countries. But in Spain, you actually get a cabin crew license.
Yes.
And you need to make do exams. And when I read through the course material that you had, it's basically a private pilot license theory that you had to pass. Yeah. And that did include things like navigation aids, for example, like aircraft systems in the cockpit, like instrumentation, things like that, which meant that you would have a better chance than most people to actually find your way around. Yes. But having said that, there's no specific airline training in any airline where we train the cabin crew to land the aircraft. We have two pilots that has to be healthy when they board the aircraft, and that's the redundancy that is built into the system. So, but I was really impressed by the amount of knowledge that you guys have.
Yeah, and you have to pass the medical to get the cabin crew license.
Yeah.
And you have to be able to swim 100 meters also in one go under 2 minutes.
Under 2 minutes.
To pass the license. Yeah. We had that, and you had two attempts.
Okay, so once again, this is specifics for Spain.
For Spain, yes. I don't know if it has changed now, because I did mine... a few years ago.
Because you're still 18. So.
Yeah, let's just leave it at that.
So, when it comes to becoming a flight attendant, then, is there any special like personality traits that you need to have in order to be successful?
Yes, of course. I mean, especially when you go for the interviews after, like you need to be a team member. You need to be able to work with the team to. You know, adapt to situations, to be flexible, you know.
Yeah.
I don't know how I passed that interview.
No, me neither. I have no idea. No, but I think the team member aspect and the flexibility and being able to adapt yourself to different situations is actually a really good...
To have quick resolve thinking, you know, like, okay, this happened or whatever, like, come up with... solutions quick.
Yeah,
like.
People skills.
Yeah,
things like that. You have to be able to deal with different personality types: people who are angry, people who are sad, people who are afraid, people who are overconfident.
Sick.
Absolutely. Well, this is getting really long now, so I'm going to shorten it down a little bit. So, what's your worst? Do you have any really bad experiences that you really remember?
I mean, I had a few. Yeah. I had a few. Like, for example, we were doing like an early day. We started like at 6 a.m. We had a 12-hour day ahead of us with 4 sectors. And on the first sector, we had someone with a heart attack. You know, we had to do CPR. We had to put oxygen. We had to, like, you name it, you know. So we landed in Germany with helicopter was waiting, ambulance, everything. We were exhausted, you know. And we still had like... 9 hours left on our day, so that really drained us.
It does. These kind of things do. Yeah. And I should say as well that if something like this is a medical emergency, which is considered, obviously, depending on how it goes for the passenger, something that's very serious. But from a crew kind of experience perspective, it's not considered a serious event, which means that it's not something that would have the cabin crew and the air crew stand down. But you would be expected to continue to work after something like that.
Yeah, we were, yes.
Yeah, on if you've had a more serious, like, technical emergency, for example, or a fire or something like that, in that case, the cabin crew and the pilots would probably be stood down, having been taken off the flight, and be given access to counselors and things like that, which is also, by the way, is something that most airlines do give to their cabin and flight crew if they feel that they were really hurt by something. So, for example, if you've had
an emergency... Maybe I took it differently because I was a person on that flight. So yeah. I had to, you know, like, deal with everything. And that day we didn't have any nurse or doctor on board. But you really hope normally if something happens, someone more qualified is going to be able to do more.
It is so helpful when you have someone who's medically qualified.
Yeah. Because absolutely.
Then, and it goes for me as well as a captain up in the front, that, you know, if I can get a doctor to have a look at the patient and give a professional opinion, it makes the decision making so much easier. Do I need to divert immediately? Can we continue to our destination? So if any one of you out there are medically qualified and someone dings for you in flight, then definitely raise your hand. You know, it helps us a lot to get help from you guys.
Then another time I had a heavily pregnant woman landing on the aisle.
Because
she
what?
Yeah, that's how I reacted to when I saw her. We were maybe, I don't know, you could hear the 100, you know, really close to land. When I see this heavily pregnant woman in row maybe 4 or 5 approaching the front, and we were sit down, you know, you have to go back to your seat. We're landing, sit down. You could just see already, you know, really close. And she was just I need to go to the toilet. I need to pee. I need to go to the toilet. I don't feel well. I was but sit down. Just, you can go straight after, but sit down.
She ended
up landing on the aisle around at row 2 or 3.
Walking.
Yeah.
Yes. This is not good.
No.
Obviously, there's nothing you can do. You don't have time to call us. If we do a go around, she might fall. If we land, she might fall.
And you don't think that quick either.
No.
You know, because the time for me to take and ding you, it was already touchdown. So I was just hoping, okay, we normally have good landings. I hope this is not going to be one of the bad ones. So it's smooth and she can hold. I think the passengers around her were trying to put their arms and everything to.
Really?
Yeah, seriously, because she was heavily pregnant. She was at least 6 months pregnant.
That's the thing, and people don't know that how dangerous that could potentially be.
No.
You know, but that's good. Good. Nothing happened.
Nothing happens, but it's so unnecessary.
it just goes to show that being a flight attendant and cabin crew member, it's just so much more, you know, about safety and about knowing these kind of things and dealing with these situations than what people think it is.
Yes.
So, great. This was great. If you guys have more questions, then, you know, put them in the comments below. I'd love to hear from you. I have Sandra here. I'm married to her, so we can utilize her more if
all
we need
the
to.
Time.
All the time. Normally, I kick her out from here when I do my videos, but I thought she would be a good one to have on this one.
Yes.
So we can ask her more questions if you guys want to. Otherwise, she is in as @MentorWife in the Mentor Aviation app, so you can ask her questions there. There are more cabin crew members in there as well. And if you want, you know, to show your allegiance to which team you are, I am obviously Team Boeing. You, for some reason, are Team Airbus.
I'm Team Boeing too. You forced me.
Okay. Yeah. So we normally Team Boeing. I just want to show
Team
Airbus.
I have two. I have with Team Boeing also.
My son Lucas has Team
Bombardier.
Yeah, because he really loves Bombardier. But there's Cessna, Piper. There are loads of them. So I'm going to put a link down here to the whole collection where you can check it out. Have an absolutely fantastic day wherever you are, guys. Keep following the channel, make sure you have subscribed, and I'll see you next time. Bye-bye. Right, guys, I really hope that you liked that. If you want more content like that, more aviation content, well then, check this out. I hope that you have subscribed to the channel and that you've highlighted the little notification bell. See you inside of the Mentour Aviation app, and have an absolutely fantastic day. Bye-bye.